Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. That was wonderful. Good morning, everybody. Welcome. I'm Brian Johnson, and I'm so glad that you're joining us this morning, May 24th, I believe it is. And we are so glad to hear you here on this Memorial Day weekend, Sunday morning. I do have a couple of announcements before we get started today, and then we'll get things rolling. So, first of all, big shout out and welcome to all visitors, near and far, if you're joining us for the first time. We're so glad you're with us. If you get on our website, send us a little information, we can send you some more information about all the certain things, all the different things we have going on here. I did want to let you know that Pastor Donna will be taking a little break next week, May 25th through the 31st. She'll be out of the office, as we have been for a long time, but she'll be doing some study leave work this next week. So please keep that in mind. Virtual things happening. Today we have fellowship hour. I don't know if it'll be a full hour, but we are fellowshipping after church today. So go to the website, use the link so you can join us for some fellowship time. I would really love to see lots of smiling faces and say hello and share what's going on in your world as we try this new experience with a fellowship time after church today. That also reminds me, we do have Wednesday Bible study, and you can join us virtually in the mornings on Wednesday and at Wednesday evening for Bible study. I wasn't supposed to, but I just throw this out there. June 14th is our Strawberry Festival Day. Get your recipes in. Really looking forward to that. Kids, I know school is almost over and you're wondering, what am I going to do? And parents are saying, gee, school's almost over. What are we going to do? So what you're going to do is you're going to go online and you're going to sign up for our digital day camp. It's called Renew Digital Day Camp. During the week of June 22nd to the 26th, we will be having some things online that you can help connect with and do with your kids at home, kids you can do at home, so that we can have some day camp, a way to connect during the week, during the summer. So please look online for that information and register so we can get information out to you about that experience. Mission trippers, it is such a difficult thing to not think about doing a mission trip, and so we have postponed our date to August. We are hoping that by August 2nd through the 8th, we will be able to have a mission trip experience, because we know that this is a defining opportunity for our young people and those that help and go with them on this mission trip experience. So please, again, go to the website, take a look at the information, and we hope that by August we'll be able to have that experience. And again, finally, just thank you again for your generosity during this time, all the different buttons and ways to help give and support us. We are so thankful. And I would also remind you, this is Memorial Day weekend. And so tomorrow, as you may do a different schedule in your day, think about those people who have served and died to protect this country. If you see someone in uniform, as they are out and about doing different work these days with our COVID experience, thank them for their service. And please honor those who have served over this Memorial Day weekend. So Jesus is here. Jesus is there. We are so glad. Let's worship the Lord this morning.
Christ be our light. Shine in our hearts. Shine through the darkness. Christ, be our light, shine in your church, gather today.
Good morning, friends. It is so good to be gathering together virtually to worship God this morning together. This is the 11th Sunday, I counted this morning, the 11th Sunday that we have been only doing live stream worship. That's a long time. And you might be wondering, how long is this going to go on? The answer is we don't know. But I did want to let you know that I sent out an email on Friday with a little more information about what session has decided, and along with a video from myself. So I hope that you'll have a chance to look at that. It will also be posted to the website sometime soon under the coronavirus tab. But in essence, what I wanted to tell you is that Session voted to continue to keep our church building closed during the yellow phase that we're in now, just because it's not safe enough for everyone to come and be here together. But the church building might be closed, but we are open. The church is open. And just go to the website and you'll find all kinds of wonderful ways that you can connect with God and one another at cpcba.org. So you are welcome to be a part of this virtual community in all kinds of ways. And the way we're going to do that today, right now, is to worship. So, friends, this is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah. Sing to Jesus, the giver of grace and mercy and love. So friends, trusting in God's grace, let us confess our sin now before God and one another. Let us pray. God of grace, in our troubled world, we confess our doubt. Lord, have mercy. In our divided country, we confess our confusion. Christ, have mercy. In our heavy hearts, we confess our fear. Lord, have mercy. Forgive us for not trusting you to be with us always. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Amen. Friends, the mercy of our God is from everlasting to everlasting. It never runs out. It never quits. There is enough for you and for me and for all who believe. So friends, believe this, the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. And now I invite the children to come together for our children's time.
Little children, come unto me. Little children, come unto me. You are made in God's image so perfectly. Little children, come unto me.
Good morning, girls and boys. Hope you're doing well today. Today we have a special treat. We have a new person here at the church. She is the new director of faith formation, and her name is Laura Bentley. And she is going to be talking with you today for the time with the children. So get ready, because here she comes.
Good morning, friends. So my name is Laura. I am new on staff at Community Church, and this is my daughter, Junia.
Hi.
She's going to be helping a little bit this morning with our children's message, and we are so excited to be with you. I can't wait to get to meet you all. But I wanted to share something Junia has in her hands that's really special to me. So this was my grandma's Bible.
It's Gigi!
I call her Gigi, and Gigi, you can see in this Bible, she wrote her name in the front. And I have it now. And my grandma, Gigi, I used to go to church with her. We sat up in the second pew in the front of the church. Most Sundays I got to go with her. And she was someone who taught me stories from the Bible. And that when I sat with her, I learned all about God's love for me and about Jesus, stories all about him. And I got to know Jesus and I got to know who God was in my life. And today in the story from scriptures, Jesus talks about his disciples being his witnesses. Now that's kind of a weird word that we don't use very often, but to be a witness means that you see something or you experience something and then you tell other people about it. And so my grandma, for me, she was a witness to who God is. And so she saw God at work. And she told me about it, and she took me to church, to a place where people see what God is doing in the world, and they talk about it there. So I wanted to figure out a way that we can help remember what this word witness means, because Jesus said his disciples are his witnesses, but we are too. We are followers, disciples of Jesus too. So I asked Junia to give me a hand with a little craft that you can probably do at home, whether with toilet paper rolls or paper towel rolls or even just paper. So we're gonna remember that to witness is to see what God is doing.
Wait for the binoculars.
And to tell people about it. So can you grab our binoculars and megaphone?
Yes.
So Junia, you wanna get back up? You can show us with your binoculars how you see. And then with the megaphone,
you talk.
You tell people. That's right. You get to talk through it. It makes you louder. So I want to encourage you all today to look for God's love in your everyday life and to tell people about it. Let's pray. Put our hands up, together, and down. Dear Jesus, thank you that we are your witnesses. I pray that you help us to see God and to tell people about God's love in our everyday, ordinary lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
God of our lives, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, so that today, as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear what you say to us. Amen. Today's reading is from the 24th chapter of Luke, beginning with the 36th verse. While they were talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have." And when he said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses to these things. And see, I am sending upon you what my father promised. So stay here in this city until you have been clothed with power from on high. Then he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. While he was blessing them, he withdrew from them and was carried up into heaven. And they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy. And they were continually in the temple blessing God. Here ends the reading.
The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Speak, Lord, speak a word. Speak a word of truth. Speak a word of hope. Speak a word of power. Speak, Lord, for your people are listening. Amen. Peekaboo, I see you. This was a game that we loved to play with our kids when they were babies. We would hide behind a chair or even just our hands and pop out and say, peekaboo, and they would squeal in delight. No matter how many times we played this game, they always seemed to be surprised to see us. Peekaboo, according to developmental psychologists, demonstrates that infants are not yet able to understand object permanence. That is, that an object is still there, even if they cannot see it, or hear it, or touch it, or sense it in any way. And so playing peekaboo with infants helps them to understand that even if an object is out of sight, it's still there. That although they thought we had gone away, we were here all along. Well, today we are marking Ascension Sunday on the church calendar. In some traditions, like the Roman Catholic Church, they celebrate Ascension as a feast. It's a great celebration of Jesus gloriously ascending into heaven. Other traditions mark Ascension as a fast. Like the Amish community, it is a time of fasting and mourning and grieving because Jesus has gone away and they are longing for him to come back. In the Reformed tradition, it is neither a feast nor a fast, but simply a forgotten day. You see, Ascension falls on a Thursday. It fell on last Thursday. And so usually we just skip right over it on Sunday. But since I can't remember ever preaching on the Ascension, I thought, well, let's give it a go and see if maybe there is something that we have to hear from this story today. So the Ascension comes to us from the last chapter of the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24. And we find that Jesus, as we know, has died, has been resurrected on Easter, right? And now he has come back and appeared to his disciples. And he came to them and he said, peace be with you. And it was as if he said, peekaboo, I see you. You thought I was gone, but here I am. Well, they were confused. They thought he was a ghost. And so Jesus had to show them his hands and his feet, and he had to sit down and have a meal with them to show them that he was really there. And then he began to explain to them. In essence, he connected the dots between Moses and all the way through the prophets, how the prophets promised a Messiah, and now to Jesus, his life, his death, his resurrection, and now his eventual ascension. And so Jesus explained all of this is as it should be. It's all part of God's plan. But before he left them, he made sure to tell them that now you are the witnesses. You are the ones who have to go out and tell the story, Tell the good news. Help people to see and to know about God's love in this world. And then he blessed them, and then he disappeared. He went off into heaven. This time, he wasn't coming back. He was gone. No more peekaboo games. He was gone for good this time. And so the disciples wondered, what now? What are we to do? Where are we to go? In their time of loss and confusion, in this time of grief and sorrow, they wanted to be close to Jesus. They wanted to go to a place where they could be close to Jesus. And so they went back to Jerusalem. They went to the temple, because the temple was a significant place for Jesus. Jesus was dedicated as an infant in the temple. When Jesus was a young boy, he was lost. Remember that story? And his parents found him in the temple. And he called it my father's house. As he got older, he went to the temple and he overturned the money changers' tables. And he said, this shall be a house of prayer. Jesus learned God's word and he preached God's word in the temple. In Jerusalem, the temple was the center of religious and cultural life. It was a sacred space. It was a holy place. People went to the temple to have their sins forgiven, their sorrows comforted, their hopes renewed. People went to the temple to remember the promises of their faith and to pray. People went to the temple in good times and in bad, in joy and in sorrow, in sickness and in health, in life and in death. People went to the temple to find the presence of the Lord their God. But now Jesus has gone away, and the disciples' spirits are crushed. And so where else could they go but the temple? And they didn't just go to the temple. They were in the temple, continually blessing God. In this time that we live today, we are also experiencing a time of loss and confusion, a time of grief and sorrow. And we want to go to a place where we can be close to Jesus. We want to go to a sacred space, a holy place. We want to go to a place where our sins can be forgiven, our sorrows comforted, and our hopes renewed. We long to go to the place that we have temple called the church, our sanctuary. And yet, it's not yet safe enough for all of us to come together in this place to worship together. And so we wonder, where can we go to find the presence of the Lord our God? Well, although the temple was the holy meeting place between God and people, and where people found the presence of God in Jesus' time, yes, but it wasn't always that way. Moses led the people through the wilderness, and God was with them in the form of a cloud and a pillar of fire, on the mountain and in manna, in the parting of the sea and in the Ark of the Covenant. Moses had the people have a portable temple. It was called Tent of Meeting. And that was a place that people could come and be in the presence of the Lord their God. And it traveled with them all the way through the wilderness. When David became king, he built a temple, David wanted to build a temple. I'm getting ahead of myself. David wanted to build a temple to God, but in essence, God said, it's not really necessary. But when David's son Solomon became king, he did build a temple, a grand temple. But when he dedicated it, this is what he said. The heavens, the highest heavens, cannot contain you, O God. How much less than this temple that I have built? So the temple was destroyed in 70 AD. And people wondered, where can we find God now? The power of the temple was never just limited to the physical space. It was a symbol of God's spiritual presence on earth as it is in heaven. God could never be contained by any building, no matter how grand or glorious or holy or cherished. God is always beyond our containers. God is in the world, everywhere in the world around us. But how can we find God in the world? How can we experience the risen Christ among us? Well, in the book of Acts, the first chapter is the other version of the ascension story, and it's told just a little differently. The same thing happens. Jesus blesses the disciples, and then he disappears into the heavens. But what the disciples do in this story is they stand staring up to the sky. It doesn't tell us how long, but I imagine it was probably a while. They were just standing there lost, looking in the sky for Jesus. And then two angels came along and they said, why? Why do you stand staring up at the sky? In essence, I think they were saying, Jesus is not limited to the sky. Jesus is not even limited to the church. Jesus is alive and well in the world today. But where? Where can we be in the presence of the Lord our God when our own sanctuary, our church building, is closed? Well, one of my favorite authors, Barbara Brown Taylor, wrote a book called An Altar in the World, A Geography of Faith. And in it, she describes some ordinary everyday practices that you can do at home in order to experience the holiness of God in the world all around us. The one chapter she writes is called The Practice of Paying Attention, and she calls that reverence. She writes this, "The easiest practice of reverence I know is simply to sit down somewhere outside, preferably near a body of water, and pay attention for at least 20 minutes. It is not necessary to take on the whole world at first. Just take the 3 square feet on earth on which you are sitting, paying close attention to everything that lives within that small estate. You might even decide not to kill anything for 20 minutes, including that salt marsh mosquito that lands on your arm. Just blow her away and ask her please to go find someone else to eat. With any luck, you will soon begin to see the souls in pebbles, ants, small mounds of moss, and the acorn on its way to becoming an oak tree. You may feel some tenderness for the struggling mayfly the ants are carrying away. If you can see the water, you may take time to wonder where it comes from and where it is going. You may even feel the beating of your own heart, that miracle of ingenuity that does its work with no thought or instruction from you. You did not make your heart any more than you made a tree. You are a guest here. You have been given a free pass to this modest domain and everything in it. And then she says this, no one has time for this, of course. No one has time to lie on the deck watching stars, or to wonder how one's hand came to be, or to see the soul of a stranger walking by. Small wonder, we are short on reverence. But that's the beauty of this quarantine, if any can be found. We do have time. We have a little extra time on our hands. And so, close the window. We have a little extra time on our hands. And so with this extra time, why not practice reverence right there at home where you are? When you are tempted to worry, practice wonder. When you are tempted to stress, practice being still. When you are tempted to be anxious, pay attention to the beauty all around you. When you are upset about not being able to come to the church to worship, open your eyes and take in the holiness of the world and your humble place in it. You might even discover a sacred space, a holy place. You might even encounter God, and you will be blessed. Well, one of my favorite poets is Mary Oliver, and I found this poem this week, which was such a blessing to find. It's called, Where Does the Temple Begin? Where Does It End? She writes this, there are things you can't reach, but you can reach out to them all day long. The wind, the bird flying away, the idea of God. And it can keep you as busy as anything else, and happier. Friends, in our little corner of the world, and it does feel little right now, I know, but in our little corner of the world, we can discover a temple, a portable sanctuary, if you will, a meeting place, a place where we can be in the presence of God and be continually blessing God and being blessed by God, who I imagine never tires of saying, peekaboo, I see you. Do you see me? You thought I was gone, but I was here all along. Thanks be to God. All the ends of the earth do praise God's name. And so in response to all of God's amazing blessings that are bestowed upon us day by day in so many ways, great and small, let us return our thanks. So ways that we can do that are using our head, our heart, and our hands. So let's start with our head in saying what we believe using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now for our prayer time, as we think about blessing God with our hearts, I wanted to offer another prayer practice you can try at home this week. And it comes actually from one of my favorite poets, Mary Oliver, that I quoted from in my sermon. And this is what she says: instructions for living a life. Pay attention, be astonished, and tell about it. Pay attention, be astonished, and tell about it. So I invite you to think about doing that this week at home, on your walks, in your backyard, in your home. Just pay attention, be astonished by something you might not have seen before, and then tell someone about it. And that would be a way that we can experience the grace of God wherever we are. And so for prayers today, I actually want to use, again, one of Mary Oliver's poems because it sounded like a prayer to me. So I'm going to use this for our prayers. So I ask you to think about what's heavy on your heart today, what is making your heart sing, and let us gather them together and let us offer them to the Lord our God. Let us pray. I know a lot of fancy words. I tear them from my heart and my tongue. Then I pray. Lord God, mercy is in your hands. Pour me a little. And tenderness too. My need is great. Beauty walks so freely and with such gentleness. Impatience puts a halter on my face, and I run away over the green fields, wanting your voice, your tenderness, but having to do with only the sweet grasses of the fields against my body. When I first found you, I was filled with light. Now the darkness grows, and it is filled with crooked things, bitter and weak, each one bearing my name. I lounge on the grass, that's all, so simple. Then I lie back until I am inside the cloud that is just above me, but very high and shaped like a fish, or perhaps not. Then I enter the place of not thinking, not remembering, not wanting. When the blue jay cries out his riddle in his carping voice, I return, but I go back. The threshold is always near, over and back, then I rise. Maybe I rub my face as though I have been asleep, but I have not been asleep. I have been, as I say, inside the cloud, or perhaps the lily floating on the water. Then I go back to town, to my own house, my own life, which has now become brighter and simpler, somewhere I have never been before. Of course, I have always known you are present in the clouds and the black oak I especially adore and the wings of birds. But you are present too in the body, listening to the body, teaching it to live. Instead of all that touching with disembodied joy, we do not do this easily. We have lived so long in the heaven of touch, and we maintain our mutability, our physicality, even as we begin to apprehend the other world. Slowly, we make our appreciative response. Slowly, appreciation swells to astonishment, and we enter the dialogue of our lives that is beyond all understanding or conclusion. It is mystery. It is love of God. It is obedience. Oh, feed me this day, Holy Spirit, with the fragrance of the fields and the freshness of the oceans which you have made, and help me to hear and to hold in all dearness those exacting and wonderful words of our Lord Jesus Christ, saying, follow me. And so we do follow our Lord Jesus Christ in praying the prayer that he taught us to pray, saying, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now we also worship and praise and bless God with our hands. And so as I've been trying to feature a different way that we can use our hands to serve God in this time, I wanted to lift up Lila DeClaver has sent me information about the Meals on Wheels that we support through our church. And she wrote this: these frontline volunteers are very grateful who prepare, serve, and deliver the meals to the seniors. We're really grateful for the contribution of face masks. Community Presbyterian Church has been such a huge help, and we really appreciate your generous donations over the years. Meals on Wheels is sustained by volunteers, local churches, and other organizations. No government funds are accepted. And the North Boroughs branch serves up to 72 counts per day. Lila's route has added 3 people recently. Demand increases since it is an essential service. But seniors are missing the personal chats and that smiling face on delivery day, since volunteers hang meals on the doorknobs now, ring the doorbell and wave and share a few words when they can. She says one driver reported the client comes to the doorway and waves with tears streaming down her face. These connections are so powerful and go both ways, friend to friend, heart to heart. She says while monetary donations are always welcome, a couple other ways to serve the clients are a phone call, cards and notes, pet food donations, or leaf raking gardening help would be appreciated. So if you're interested in doing any of those things to help with Meals on Wheels, you can complete the Angels Ministry form on our website, or reach out to Lila or the church and we'll get you in contact with her. And we'll be in touch with you to help you be an angel here on earth. So whether you give to the church or our church or another church or a nonprofit organization that's trying to help during this time, whether you give money or give your time, let us give it all with gratitude for the one who has blessed us so abundantly. And now for this time of doxology, I invite you to listen to Janet Kenny Smith as she plays for us God Mounts His Throne with shouts of joy. Thank you. And now, having given our gifts to God, let us now dedicate them using our prayer of dedication. Let us pray. Gracious God, in response to the gift of your amazing grace and eternal love, we offer ourselves to you. Open our minds to learn and grow. Open our hearts to share our love. Open our hands to help others in need. Bless our humble offerings. Make them holy reflections of you. We pray in the name of Jesus, the risen Christ. Amen. Now, friends, let us go into this week and do three things. Pay attention, be astonished, and then tell about it, knowing that you will encounter God and you will be blessed. So may God bless you and keep you. May God be kind and gracious to you. May God look upon you with favor and give you peace, now and always. Amen.
God be with you till we meet again. Loving counsels guide and uphold you with a shepherd's care and fold you. God be with you till we meet again.
And now, friends, I invite you to pass the peace however you can, wherever you are. And as you do so, we will be blessed by the Avonworth High School Chamber Choir that is giving us a peace blessing today. And they will be singing Amane Utupe, and that means grant us peace, give us courage. So the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.